It's my joy to say yes to you. It's my honor to say yes. Whatever it looks like, my response is yes. My response is all that I am, all that I am. Oh, let the sound of surrender fill the room, 'cause we love.
Folks finding their seats. That's good. That means they've been fellowshipping and talking and getting to know each other and talking about great things. And we've got the youth back from camp, so that's good. Woo! They made it up there, had a good time and made it back, so that's a praise and a blessing. And Tracy was able to walk into the building here this morning, so that's a blessing. She still has hair also. I want to be sure to put that out over the internet. And she made it through youth week. So we're glad everybody's here. Those that are tuning in from home, we're glad you guys have decided to do that. Others will be watching this maybe at a later time, but we're always glad to have folks tune in and watch the broadcasts, and hopefully we're going to have a great message today. What do you think, Pastor? Great message today? Yeah. Pretty good message today. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the service today, we'll do thumbs up, thumbs down. That would send Pastor into the Monday resignation day. Yeah. Typical Mondays. Well, we don't want to do that then. Let's be encouragers. Anyway, we're glad you guys are here. We're glad that we've got at least one visitor. And so those that might be tuning in, if you got prayer requests or needs, you can reach out to us. You can contact the pastor, contact church office. Of course, those in the building here, you've got the cards there. You'd be welcome to fill that out, drop it in the offering plate. And we're glad everybody's here. I'm sure a few others will be coming in. We're going to have some good songs and some good words. So let's pray. Lord, thank you that we get the opportunity together, Lord. I do thank you that the youth were able to go and have a good time. I thank you for those adults that sacrificed time and probably a little bit of mental taken away there, Lord, just because the youth, they got a lot of energy and they go, go, go. And Lord, I know it was probably a challenge sometimes, but I know that it was probably a blessing also. Lord, I thank you that they were able to go up there in the van safely and return safely. I thank you for the leadership of that. I thank you for them just having a good time. And Lord, we look forward to hearing about their trip. And Lord, we pray that it'll be something that'll make a difference in their lives, throughout their lives. Lord, we thank you now that we get to have the opportunity and privilege to be able to meet together here as a family. We pray that you bless through the songs, through the instruments. For those that are not in the building, Lord, that they're doing it through technology, through online, Lord, I pray that you'd bless them. I pray that they would just get their tanks filled up, Lord, that you'd just help them, Lord. I know it's so easy to be discouraged. There can be physical, there can be mental, there can be spiritual concerns, Lord. I pray that you just meet those. And Lord, I pray that you bless today in a special way and just meet each of our needs and just give us a great day. And Lord, we thank you for the honor and privilege of being able to be here today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Here we go. We're live from Revive.
All right. Thank you so much, John. If you guys would, please stand up with us. Let us celebrate and proclaim to the world we are not ashamed of our Savior. Through my heart, he's lost his grip on me. Should also be overwhelmed. Oldie but a goodie. no one more beautiful. You are beautiful. God, you are the most beautiful.
Yeah.
Something that we, I think, need to learn how to do is to connect our worship in this moment to our worship in life, and to understand that that's following Him in obedience, stepping into what He has called us to, and knowing that we go when where He calls us to go, that He's going to provide the way. He's never going to take us into a place that He's not going to give His provision, His Spirit, and His love.
darkness, it's my God, that is who you are.
Let's take this next moment to confess to God the places where you lack faith, the places where you are afraid, the places where you need him to show up, because he has promised to make a way every place he calls us to. Some of the best I have heard you guys sing. Somebody turned up my ear monitors and they were like blaring and I could still hear them. It was awesome. It was awesome.
Very nice. Good. Let's job, give the guys. Lord a hand a seat for yes. that. So you guys did real good. Of course, our folks on instrument and singing just did a great job. That's a professional level. And of course, we want it to where we can praise the Lord and do it first class, that's for sure. So while we're doing that and doing it in a first-class fashion, and I'll tell you, that song, they were singing loud. I saw Carl about ready to break into a dance back there. On every drum beat, he was moving. All right, join me, if you would, saying our church mission statement. So repeat after me. Share new life in Jesus.
Share new life in Jesus.
And develop Christ followers.
Who changed the world.
There we go. And if you were going to try to be a part of that on a Sunday morning and you wanted to go to a traditional or classic type service, what time would you probably want to be here on Sunday? Very good. You get an A on that so far. Let's don't bomb this. And then if you wanted to be in a service like this with more contemporary Christian music, some great singing, great preaching. About what time would you probably want to be here on Sunday? Very. Yeah.
For those that have
a
little trouble being on time.
Yeah, and I know Carl's going to beat the drum on this one here. All right, let's say our grow groups, seeing how I was late getting there as normal. Grow groups on Sunday morning, that's our Sunday school. So, Carl, what time should I be there each Sunday morning? Under the pressure, Carl gave the wrong time. But anyway, I am. Actually, he probably had it right. He was saying the time that I normally get there. All right, so 9:15 is our grow groups. And then Wednesday night, the youth meet at?
6:30.
And we say what? Excellent. And midweek services at what time? 7 o'clock. Very good. And if we had some type of a kids type program, class, little group gathering where they eat, play games, do some Bible study, what would we call that? Very good. That meets each Wednesday night at what time? 5 o'clock till about 8 o'clock. And eventually they're going to have the Kingdom's Kid Camp that they can go to and have a good time. And I'm sure they'll need some helpers with that. And let's see, tonight at 5 o'clock, let's see if anybody remembers this previous announcement. 5 o'clock, what is going on here at the church? Close. Church council, that's correct. All right, and Paul, for Paul, next Sunday, right after the church service, this service right here, we are having a? Excellent, yes. All right, we're having a business meeting. So we got church council tonight at 5 o'clock and then business meeting at next Sunday, right after the church service. And we've got the offering plates. Ladies, if you want to go ahead and come on down. And then after the offering, we've got, I think, a group that's going to sing just a little bit. That'll be great. Before the offering plate is brought around, that'll give you time to write out your check, grab your $100 bills. Those at home, You can participate also, of course, in the house or at home. You can do it through Venmo or through PayPal. And so we appreciate anything that you can give. Story is told of a church much like our church, with a pastor much like our pastor, not necessarily our pastor. He was preaching on a Sunday, and it was going along in the service pretty good. He was probably into about 15, 20 minutes. And all of a sudden, he decided to go on a little rabbit trail, and he said, if I could, I'd take all the beer, and I'd pour it in the river. And then he preached on, different little part of the message, preached on for about another 15, 20 minutes. And then he said, all of a sudden, he says, if I could, I'd put all the wine in the river, all of it, in the river. Then he preached on for about another 20 minutes. Tells you how long he had to preach, right? Anyway, for another 20 minutes, and then he's just on another tangent, and he says, and if I had all the liquor, I'd put all the liquor in the river. And so then he preached on. Next thing you know, it's time for the song, like we're going to have here in a minute. It's time for the song. And so the song leader gets up with a little sheepish kind of smile on their face and said, our next song that we're going to sing is Shall We Gather at the River. All right, so let's pray. Let's pray. Lord, thank you that we get together and have a good time, Lord. I thank you that we can have a good time in your word. We can have it in your music. Lord, I thank you for the girls being ready to take the offering. Thank you for those that's been blessed, Lord, that they're able to give. Lord, I pray that you multiply it, use it. Lord, I thank you that you do take care of us. You give us health. You give us food. You give us cover overhead. You give us transportation. Lord, you do take care of us, meet every need. So, Lord, we give back a little bit of portion for you. And, Lord, you multiply it. For those that are unable to do that just because of the circumstances they're in, Lord, I pray that you bless them and just work in their lives and just encourage them and build them up. And, Lord, just bless the rest of the service. Bless this song that they're about to sing. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
One thing about the God that we serve, we're so excited because he's a God that breathes life into us. All the way in Genesis, he breathed life into our nostrils. The very first pulmonary person was Jesus Christ. He breathed inside of us the life in our lives.
You are life, you give light to the dark, yes, you restore. on, can we stand on our feet and just give God praise in this place? We want you to worship with us just for a moment. Some environment that would make preaching.
I can tell you guys are already pumped up and ready to jump into God's word. Out of control. Out of control. All right, confession time. Who are you in debt to? Go ahead, put it on the table. Capital. I was wondering if anybody would take that bait. Okay, we're gonna assume over the next 30 seconds or so, we're speaking hypothetically or with other people, right? All right, so where do our debts as a people lie? And don't try to like be all spiritual and be like, Jesus, I know you're way more in debt than just that, right? What else you got going on? I was going to say, you guys live indoors. I've been to some of your houses. So, yeah, there's a house. What else? A car. What else? Oh, lots of credit cards. Lots and lots of credit cards. Food. Yeah. What was over here? Student loans. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, yeah. We won't confess to how many of us are swimming in student loans. We don't need all that. So you get the idea. We owe a lot of money to a lot of people. Real quick search last night, the Federal Reserve said as of 2020 that Americans owe $14 trillion in consumer debt. I don't even have enough fingers and toes for that. That's just crazy. But what we're going to talk about this morning is a different kind of debt. As we dive into Romans 13, we are still actually applying some of the things that we learned last week. But the overarching theme that Paul gives us is that we are to live as a people who are in debt and owe a debt of love. If you think about that imagery, it's pretty amazing. In most of our lives, we're told to live without being in debt because it can be a trap and it can make life super difficult on you. But Paul's going to tell us, don't have other debt, but owe a debt of love and owe that debt of love to people. But here's where I want to make sure we get off on the right page in understanding that the debt that we pay that debt of love to others, but the debt we really owe to Him. And so really the thought process goes like this: God loves me, so I should love others. Jesus died for me, so I should love others. I have a home in heaven, so I should love others. My sin has been forgiven. I should love others. I have been healed and restored, and God puts up with all my junk, and I should love others. Does that make sense? Like, that's where we're going this morning. And so for much of our study in Romans, I've been trying to give us, like, most of the chapter. And as I studied and just kind of meditated and prayed over this, I really just zeroed in on the center, which talks about love. I do want to hit on something, though, just because of the place we have come through. So if you haven't already, if you would, join me in Romans 13. And I want to point out that that the first part of this chapter is probably would be difficult for most of us. And I commit it to you for your own personal study, because what Paul talks about is the way we respond to government. And I'm just saying to you, for your benefit and for your growth in Christ, I would like you to read those first 6 or 7 verses, and I would like you to reflect over 2020 in your life. Like, not your neighbor, not those people online that you got frustrated at, not the news anchors, not President so-and-so. I want you to go back and read those verses and meditate on your own heart and your own attitude, because here's the bottom line of what Paul writes. He wrote to a people who were in subjugation to the Roman Empire. He wrote to people that did not get to vote on their leader. And he said, honor them, revere them, and see them as an instrument of God. And so for maturity's sake, we need to stop sometimes and say, did I get caught up in the crazy last year? Or did I do what God's word says? Because here's our pivotal verse from last week. Do not conform to the pattern of this world. When the world is out of control because they're screaming because they want so-and-so in office and so-and-so out of office, are we acting like that, or do people see Jesus in us? That is what matters more than anything else. Are we being conformed to the world, or are we being transformed by the renewing of our mind? And so normally I only talk about this kind of stuff during election season, but then every time I do, even though I have never stood up here and said, vote for this guy or vote not for that guy or woman or whatever, I've never done that. I get accused of it a whole lot, because what I want you to hear is respond biblically in every situation. At the end of the day, if you vote for the one I wanted you to vote for, but you didn't do it with a biblical heart and attitude, it doesn't matter. If your candidate won, so what if your heart wasn't right? If your candidate lost, so what if your heart wasn't right? Are we being conformed to the image of this world? Are we being transformed by the renewing of our mind? And I have to tell you, like last week, somebody said, you know what? I really didn't appreciate the sermon this week because you jumped all over my toes. I have bad news. This is not going to be any better. You can already tell by the way we're starting off. It's not going to get any better from here. I'm just going to be honest. But hey, I'm just the messenger. It's his message. I'm going to do the best that I can to be faithful to his word and what he says. If you want to take it out on me, that's fine. I'm here for that. But for the most part, these are his words and not mine. I want you, as we make this turn, and I'm going to start reading in a second in verse 8, I want you to be mindful of what true love, what true biblical love is. So he started off with that bang, right? Like you're under government authority, respect them, honor them, see them as an instrument of God in place by God's sovereign will. And then he makes this turn in verse 8. Let no debt... Well, let's go ahead and grab verse 7. It makes a little bit more sense in the context when you do that. Verse 7, give to everyone what is owed them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. So I'm sorry, you cannot evade taxes. All right? Christian brothers and sisters, pay your taxes. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. In other words, pay your bills. Here go. Listen to this, though. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt of love to one another. For whoever loves has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other commandments there may be, about 600 or so of them in the Old Testament, whichever ones he said there may be, are all summed up in one command, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfillment of the law. Bottom line is this, like for the whole thing, and I'm sorry I keep saying that, but I'm trying to make it simple because I love simple. It's a lot easier to live out. God could have given this checklist of hundreds of things to do, but God has always been and always will be more concerned about our hearts. It doesn't matter if we keep the list if the heart's not in the right place. And so that's where God always goes, is to our hearts. And so real simply put, it's this. Don't pattern yourself after the world. Be transformed by God's word. So then, the opposites we're dealing with this morning are not love and hate, but selfishness and love. The difference is, often we think the opposites are love and hate, but in reality, love is, I will serve you, I will care for you, I will put you first. Hate is, I just want to wipe you out. But selfishness is, I will serve me and put me first, and you don't matter. Because I come first. That's the spectrum we're working in this morning. And so when he says, love your neighbor as yourself, when he says, have a debt that you owe to each other of love, the idea is that we make that switch in our minds that we are continually moving from self-centered to other-centered. Because here's the deal. We didn't have to be taught how to be selfish. How many of you have had a 2-year-old in your house? Did you have to teach them to say mine? Like, you taught them some things, right? You taught them ABCs. You taught them 1, 2, 3s. You taught them how to use a spoon. You taught them how to use a straw. You taught them to put their clothes away. You never sat down and told them, say mine when you want stuff. But did they do it? Yeah. Did you? Now, intentionally speaking, did you intentionally teach them how to throw a tantrum? No, you may have shown them what it looks like for an adult to throw a tantrum. I may have shown them what it looks like for an adult to throw a tantrum, but we never taught our kids how to have a tantrum intentionally. The point being is we learn by nature, by our sinful nature. Remember, that was where Paul started in Romans 1, 2, 3, that we have a sinful nature that we have inherited from our parents and that we have fully embraced in ourselves, and that's why we were wrecked and separated from God. We don't have to be taught that part. What we have to continually be taught by the transformation of our mind is how to love and put others first. That's the hard stuff. So keeping with the theme, it is okay to be in debt. Ooh, Dave Ramsey just had a mini stroke. It is okay to be in debt if it is a debt of love. That's where we want to go this morning. So I want us to think a little bit about love, and to your surprise or chagrin or whatever it may be, we're not going to go to 1 Corinthians 13. I want to focus primarily on the words of Jesus this morning, but I want to start with this idea as we go into the idea of a debt of love. It first is that love does no harm. He ends this whole passage that way. Verse 9, he says, let me find it. It's hiding. Oh, it's way up there. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet. Whatever other commandment there is, they're all summed up in this. Love your neighbor as yourself. But catch this, love does no harm to a neighbor. Love does not intentionally hurt people. And so I want to dive into just one thing, because I think this hits to the point of how you know you are living in love. We can diagnose it like a doctor. You know how much you love people when you disagree with them. You see, when we agree, it's easy. That's why we have a saying that says the honeymoon phase or the honeymoon is over. Like, we think of that as married couples. Most people, if they go away for a honeymoon, it's a weekend or it's a week or whatever. But sometimes 6 months later, a year later, we say the honeymoon is over. And why do we say that? What happens? They start bickering because somebody finally got honest and said, I got an opinion. It doesn't match up with yours, and I want my way, and I'm tired of giving you your way. You flush the toilet wrong. You put the toilet paper on wrong. You brush your teeth the wrong way. I'm tired of your face. You know, whatever it may be, suddenly someone speaks truth, and there is conflict because there are two competing wills. And if you survive that, then you know that you are acting in sacrificial love. But it's not just with married couples, right? Like, we have siblings disagree, adults disagree, kids disagree, employees, staff, bosses, committees, like Baptists, like all areas of life, we have conflict. And so here's what I want you to think of. When Paul says to embrace the continual debt of love to one another, I want you to start thinking about how you handle it with someone else when you disagree with them. So some of you know that we had a pretty sizable meeting on Tuesday night. Two of our core teams came together, personnel and finance, and we were talking through some stuff. Do you think there was disagreement? Those that were in the room can't answer. Do you think there was disagreement? Of course there was. Where two or three are gathered together, there's going to be disagreement. It's going to happen. So then, are we called in love to always agree? Of course not. We're called to handle that disagreement well. And here, if I can brag on our team for a little bit, I feel like that was what happened Tuesday. We had opposing views. Those opposing views were expressed, sometimes emotionally, and that's okay too. Like, we're not called to be like Stoics who have no emotion, and that's how you be like Jesus. Like we have emotion. It's a gift from God, and sometimes it comes out. The end result is what matters. Like, what do you do with that emotion? How do you handle that emotion? How does it impact your words, as we'll talk about in a minute? And so if we're going to do no harm to our neighbor as a way of showing love, then when we come to those points when we disagree, what we've got to learn to do is to control the things that come out of our mouth. And what I want us to embrace as a church family is this desire to protect each other. That I can disagree with Jason, but I'm going to protect him with my words and with my actions. And so if he's not with me, I'm going to say things that don't tear him down. I might relay a conversation or an event that took place, but I'm going to do that in a way that protects him and shows honor to him, because that is what I am called to do. And so we walk away from those disagreements with a desire to build the other one up and protect them and take care of them, because that is how we do no harm. But I also just want us in general to dive into this idea of love. And I want you to focus your love in three areas. Paul is encouraging us to have a debt of love to each other that we owe because of what Christ did on our behalf. That in that love we would do no harm, or we would protect each other. But I also want us to understand, you see, it's not about this long list of do's and don'ts. What's significant about what Paul says here, he's quoting Jesus. Remember, here's the scene, and we'll walk all the way through this whole scene in a few minutes. But the scene is Jesus has been out, and he has been teaching. You can see this in Luke 10 and I think one other place. But you see in Luke 10, he's been teaching, and a teacher of the law, a Pharisee, someone of that nature, comes to him, and they pose the question like they always did: what is the greatest commandment? So help me out here. You know what the answer is, right? So the guy comes, what is the greatest commandment? And Jesus says, yeah, that's it. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind. Something like that, right? Yeah, we always get confused on the last one. Love God with all your heart and with all your mind. Like soul, spirit, strength. It's something like that. I don't know, but you get the idea. Love God above everything else. And then he adds to it, though, right? And second, he says, is to love your neighbor as yourself. And then he says this, all of the law and the prophets hang on these two commands. And what I want us to understand, because a lot of us, let's be honest, a lot of us grew up with this idea of, I've got to keep all the rules. I've got to do all the right things. I've got to not do all the wrong things. Where Jesus wants us to love God, focus on that. What would happen if, man, what would happen if we just took a week, just 30 days, and focused on loving God? And I'm not meaning like on a mountain, like somewhere away from everybody, because if we love God, then we're going to go to work because that's the right thing to do. If we love God, we're going to care for our family because it's the right thing to do. Do you see how they hang together? He said, love God with all that we are, and as an extension of loving God. They're not separate. It's not love God, love others, and if they compete with each other, just, you know, roll dice and see what happens. Love God by loving others. And we love them with our words. We talked about that, right? James says that our words are like a raging fire birthed in hell. Our words are serious. Like, they can tear people down. Proverbs says that our words have the power of life or death. And so whether someone is with us or away from us, we need to speak words that speak life, that protect others, that guard them and love them. And if we're working on loving God and we're working on loving others, then we want to form our words in that way. And that doesn't mean you're never going to be frustrated with someone. It doesn't mean you're never going to have to seek counsel with someone else and vent that frustration so you don't kill somebody. Like, do that. Like, I don't want to visit you in jail. I would rather you get that stuff out. We have Ted. We have other leaders. You can vent that stuff. But there's a way we can vent that speaks life or death. And then our love should flow through our actions. We're going to dig into this a little bit more in a moment, but I had a conversation yesterday that I'm going to share with you more at the very end of our service, and one of the things that came up from that was chapter 1 of James, where James says, religion that is pure and is faultless is to care for widows and orphans. Love that is truly honoring of God should come out in our actions. And the church has got to start understanding that means that we do things about what we see going on in the world. If someone is poor and needy, before we worry about signing them up for Dave Ramsey so they can get their finances together, we need to meet the need. One of the most pitiful, sad deacons meetings I ever sat in was the very first one I was in. I was associate pastor in our church, and the pastor had invited me to start coming to deacons meetings as a way of mentoring me and having another godly voice in the room. Sat down with, I think it was like five or six deacons that we had, my pastor and me, and the pastor brings this need to the deacons. They were the ones like here that oversaw the benevolence program. And so he comes in, and there was a well-known single mom in our church that had two or three young boys, young teenage to like elementary age. And they were about to be evicted from their house because they were behind on rent payments. And so pastor brings this whole thing, and it was not going to cost that much to get them caught up. To me, it was an easy decision. Like mom with kids about to be on street, pay bill, help after. Makes sense. Those men spent 30 minutes deciding what we should do to help her get her bills together. And finally, you know, you try to hold back when you know you're the new guy, fresh face in the back of the room that probably nobody's going to listen to anyway. But finally, after 30 minutes, I couldn't take anymore. I'm literally like, all right, guys, like, don't kill me. I know I'm new. But shouldn't we keep her off the street, then sign her up for counseling? Like, does anybody else see that as a possible solution? That since her rent is due Friday and it's Tuesday and we've got the money, maybe we should pay the bill and make sure they're okay and then talk about the other stuff. I'm not saying that's not important. I'm not saying she didn't make poor choices to get herself here. But maybe we need to care for the need first. You know why people stopped coming to the church? By the way, if you didn't realize, they do. They don't come anymore. There was a day where you had an issue. Even if you didn't belong to the church, you would go to the church because you knew you could get help. They've stopped coming because they have stopped getting help. Because we're more worried about the bottom line. Big ouch. Our love needs to flow through actions. that we would care enough about the hearts of people that we would serve them even if they don't come to church, that we would feed them if they never darken the door of a worship service, that we would pay their rent so they have a place to stay for the next 30 days, even if 30 days from now they're in the same problem. As I have never seen once in Scripture where Jesus asked for a budget sheet before he helped somebody. And then our thoughts. Have you ever gotten into an argument? A good argument. Like digging your heels in, about to go to Duke's, like good argument. And somewhere in that argument, something begins to turn back here because of something said, and you realize you got in that argument because you misunderstood something. I've had that happen a few times in my life. Had somebody at one point that left our church because they misunderstood something I said, and like 6 months later in a conversation, we figured that out. Right after the very first time I went to training for the marriage conferences that I lead in the National Guard, I got back, had a conversation with Priscilla. I don't even remember what it was, but I realized in the conversation, because I finally started practicing active listening, that she and I were saying the exact same thing. And I would like to say that my gut reaction was, well, we can fix this because we're actually on the same page. Actually, for a half second, my thought was, I can win this because I know where she's going now. But that was wrong. I repented. I fixed that. Okay. But my point is this, that we need to love with our words. We need to love with our actions. We need to understand that love starts, though, with what the Bible would call the heart, but is our thoughts. I can't tell you how often I beat the drum of give the benefit of the doubt to have people argue with me. And here's why we argue with that. Because we are conformed to the image of this world without realizing it, and we're worried about being walked on, we're worried about being taken advantage of, we're worried about not proving them wrong and us right, and in that moment, we would rather keep fighting, or we would rather keep our guard up than to give the benefit of the doubt and it possibly not go the way we want it to. But if we really want to learn to love people, then it starts up here. I shared with you guys that somewhere around the beginning of the year, that was something that God started working with on my heart. And it wasn't that I had this overarching frustration or hatred or anger or any of that stuff, but God just started calling me to this place where he said, I want you to love people more. And as I began to flesh that out with God and pray through it and search through his word, the realization I came to is that it's got to start up here. It's got to start with when someone frustrates me with their action, that I've got to reframe it right then. And remember we talked about last week, we take those thoughts captive, we make them submissive to God's word, and we begin to go in that direction. So the very thought, that the very time that the thought is birthed, that is when we have to take control of it and put it in the right direction. And that is how we begin to guide ourselves to love people more. If we let those thoughts spiral out of control, then it goes the absolute wrong direction. And so this is how we love. By the way, if you want to compare it, then you can go on your own time again to 1 Corinthians 13. You'll see it lines up with the things that he tells us to do there. But I also want us to, for a minute, meditate on Jesus' words for love. So this was one of those weeks where things were just a little bit more crazy in the office than I would have liked for them to be. And so I didn't get to study this portion until last night. And so late last night after a family conversation, I just got alone with God as much as I could in a house full of six people and two dogs. And the thought that kept coming to me was, look into the hard things that Jesus said about love. You see, we want the feel-good stuff, right? We want the things that pump us up and get us excited about love and make us feel good on the inside. But I want you, as I need to, I still need to, a little bit more, but I want you to evaluate your life in light of these words and reflect on how countercultural this is from where we would normally go in our thought of what love and relationships and all that look like. And start off with a big one. Love your enemies and those who hurt you. The words Jesus used were love your enemies and pray for those that persecute you. Give without expecting anything in return. How many times does Jesus say, if they ask for your coat, give them your coat. If they ask for your tunic, give it to them. If they give it back, great. If they don't, that's okay too. Forgive as you've been forgiven. Oh man, this is hard. As I said last week, we would much rather go Liam Neeson on somebody. But God's word says turn the other cheek. Not that cheek or that cheek, but this cheek, right? You guys like that? I thought of that at like 2 o'clock this morning. Yeah, I thought you'd like that. Care for the poor and the sick. Occasionally, I try to just pull back and pause and think about our ministry as a whole and ministry in general within our culture. And you know, unfortunately, if you look at the church in America, most of our ministry is probably designed around the people that give the most money. I mean, I've been in churches that have had like full-time staff devoted to our seniors because they give the money and next to nothing for kids and youth. They were forsaking the next generation to take care of the current generation because we hope they will give us money. You're not going to see that line up anywhere in Scripture. Am I saying we neglect our seniors? Absolutely not. I'm saying we engage our seniors and remind them they have something productive to do, and we mobilize them for kingdom work rather than asking them to sit back and go to like fun luncheons and stuff like that. Like we teach them and disciple them still. They have a place in the kingdom and a purpose in the world, and we teach them to love on the next generation, so we take care of both at the same time. But it's not about taking care of those that have money. He actually told us to pour resources into the poor and the sick, visit people in prison. And Jesus also said that hate is equal to murder. He called us to really, really difficult things in order to show love. But I want you to think about what we see in the world and how much does the world need to see that. And how many of us this last year have seen people literally screaming at each other that people need to be taken care of? That is completely counter-biblical. Like, we need to take care of these people. No, we need to take care of these people. You're an idiot. We need to take care of these. You're a moron. What? And I'm not talking about, like, Fox News. I'm talking about Christians. Not saying Fox News aren't Christians. I'm just saying. I'm not talking about personalities on TV. Let me rephrase it that way. I'm not talking about personalities on TV. I'm talking about, like, people in, like, normal life situations. Seen relationships end because of differences in opinion when we should be sitting down saying, how can I listen to you and how can I learn from you? I'm trying to practice that in my own life. I have a guy that I met in the military that has almost polar opposite views to me on everything. And every time I am tempted to go into social media and just to shut that off so I don't have to read what he has to say, the Holy Spirit goes, do you really want to close off another view, or are you willing to listen? Not that I'm going to change, because I believe his views are actually unbiblical. But if I lose the ability to listen to an opposing view, then guess what? Today I'm shutting him off. Tomorrow it might be you. Tomorrow it might be my wife. Tomorrow it might be my kid. Because I don't want to hear something that's different from what I think. And so I learn and build the habit of shutting those things off. And I challenge you. Be welcoming of opposing views in your life and listen to them and evaluate them with a loving heart and keep that conversation going. So back to the scenario I painted a little earlier. So Jesus has been teaching and the guy comes and he said, what is the greatest commandment? Jesus says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. The second one is like it. He says, love your neighbor as yourself. So the dude who now shows his cards, because from the beginning he just wanted to justify himself. So now he's looking for the loophole. Okay, then so who is my neighbor? Who do I really have to love? If I have to love, then fine, I will love if you're going to make me, but who do I have to love? And Jesus tells the story, not only displaying what neighbor is, but displaying what true biblical love looks like. Amazing thing about this story, if you know it, you know that the main character, the hero of the story, is a Samaritan. A little bit of history. Old Testament, way back long before these people lived, except for Jesus, of course, because he's eternal. But everybody else, before they had been born, hundreds of years, the Samaritans had been a full-blooded part of Israel. But during the time of the conquest, the other nations that would come in, their habit was that they would come in, they would conquer a city, they would take some of the inhabitants away, and they would replace them with others in order to subjugate them. So in this case, all the other cities in Israel still remain true to God's designed that they would not intermarry with the other races, but the Samaritans did not hold that. And so they intermarried with other races, and they became this whole other group that then became the outcast of Israel. You're not true Jews. You can't come worship in the temple. You are nothing to us. You're dead to me. It's like that kind of thing going on for hundreds of years. Fast forward to Jesus' time. Jesus takes that person. Ooh, I hear myself. That's cool. The Matrix? Anyway, so Jesus takes that guy and makes him the hero of the story. In order to confront our own prejudices and our own bents, what I want you to do as we walk through the story, every time I say Samaritan, I want you to honestly think of the person or the culture or the kind of personality that you struggle with the most. Because that is exactly what Jesus did. He took the person they would struggle with the most, and he made him the hero. So the way the story goes that he told them is that this man was traveling, and he was going down the road near Jerusalem, and he gets beat up by robbers. Everything is stolen. He's left on the side of the road for dead, in desperate need, desperately hurt. If you leave him there and do nothing, he is going to die. And so what comes along next is a priest and a Levite at different times. The crowd Jesus is talking to, they would have thought they were the heroes. But these guys come through, and for whatever reason, there's all kinds of speculation, but Jesus didn't tell us, so it doesn't matter. They come by, they look at the guy, they see the guy, they see the need, and they walk on by. They were not neighbors. They did not show love. But then comes the Samaritan. The Samaritan is the one that would be despised by everyone hearing the story. The Samaritan is the outcast. The Samaritan is the one that you would think Jesus would make the robber, but no, he's the hero. He comes by, he sees it, and Jesus said he has compassion on the man, and he cares for his wounds. And he takes him to a place where he can be cared for, and he leaves him in the inn, and he leaves money. And he says to the one in charge of the inn, take care of his needs. When I come back, if there is anything lacking, I will pay the bill. The Samaritan gave of his time. The Samaritan gave of his money, his intellect, everything. He brought it to bear on the need that he saw. And then Jesus looks at the crowd and says, okay, who was the neighbor? Do you see the word play he did? The guy that wanted to justify himself says, who is my neighbor? Who's the person that I have to be nice to? Who's the person I have to love? Jesus flips that on its head and said, who acts like a neighbor? Who did the right thing? Who saw the need and met it and took care of it? That's the way you need to pattern your life. When Paul wrote that we need to live as though we have a debt of love that we can never repay, and he said, do no harm, and understand that when you do this, you fulfill all of the law. That is the picture he was giving us. As I said earlier, though, it's not about memorizing right and wrong and things that I should do, things that I should not do. So I want to take you to one more place where Jesus' words help us. Matthew chapter 6, Jesus is talking about several different things, but one of the things he gets into is money. And we looked at this not too terribly long ago, I think. But he poses the question about, is our treasure on earth or in heaven? He says, you want to put your treasure in heaven because it's going to be taken care of there and it's not going to be destroyed. But on earth, it's uncertain and it can be taken by robbers. Moths can come in and eat it or whatever. And he says this really vital thing, where your treasure is, your heart will be also. And so as we get ready to wrap things up this morning, I want to ask you, where is your heart? In other words, what do you value? Because the things that we value, this is what Jesus was getting to, is the things that we value are the things that we love. And so I want to ask you for some questions for just reflection. Do you value people or possessions? Do you value God's kingdom or yours? Do you value preserving the relationship or being right? Do you value venting your anger or honoring God? In all of those situations, true love is displayed when we choose one versus the other, when we value that thing. And as I said earlier, it's a heart issue. It's not memorizing the right course of action. It's having our hearts in a place that we are inclined to lean towards the right thing. And as we learned last week, remember the end of that phrase when he said, don't be conformed to the image of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, and then you will be able to know and approve what God's will is, his good, perfect, pleasing will. The idea is when we incline our hearts towards God, we're better able to hear his voice. And so in those moments where we begin to lean the wrong direction, the Holy Spirit is speaking. When we've worked on transforming our heart and our mind so that we can hear God's voice, then we'll understand where God's prodding us so that we can get back on track and move in obedience. And that's what I'd like you to focus on this morning, is where in truth is your heart? If you could, like this young man in the picture, peer into a box in the place where your heart is, what are the treasures that would be there with it? Is it the financial stuff and getting ahead and accumulating a 401k account that carries you through the retirement years? Is it a certain house or a certain car or a certain status? Is it people looking at you and thinking good things about you? Is it that next promotion? Is it the dollar amount that's associated with your salary? Is it whatever? Or is it the things of God? You know, I think of Micah. What do you want from me, God, to do justice and to love mercy and walk humbly with your God? Is it inclining our hearts to loving God and loving others and doing that so boldly that when God asks us to do something crazy, we're not as worried about the balance sheet as we are worried about following God? Can't tell you how many people have pulled me aside and said, like, pray for me. I want to surrender to missions, but I'm afraid God will call me to such and such. I want to surrender to do this, but I'm afraid God will call me to such and such. Well, that tells us where our heart is and that we're not surrendered. If there's a part of us that says, I want to follow God, but, then we need to deal with our but. I just needed to lighten things for a second. We need to deal with our but, and then, we can move forward in obedience with God. That's what he's called us to do. And it's the best place that we can live. As we sing this song that says, I will build my life on you and your love and your word, I want you to confess those things this morning. Be brave enough this morning to say, I recognize through the Holy Spirit the places where I'm coming up short, and I want to deal with those things and leave them at your altar, leave them before the cross. Whatever imagery helps you, I want to leave those. I want to walk away. I want to be like your son. Remember we said in Romans 8, that was the goal, right? He's forming us in the image of his son. I want to be like Jesus. And that means I've got to leave some baggage behind. Maybe as you pray through things this morning, you realize you have surrendered your life to God, but you've never been baptized. Maybe you've been visiting with us for a while and you're like, yes, I want to be in this church, do life with these crazy people. These are my people. To serve my God with them. Maybe there's a sin you need to unburden yourself with. Maybe there's something you need prayer for. Use this time for that. Don't fall into the rut of just doing the religious thing, which is we stand when they tell us to stand, we sing when they tell us to sing, and then we go home. Be changed. Let God's word richly dwell in your heart this morning and follow it where it leads you. There's no better place to live. Let me pray for you. Father, we commit this time to you, and we ask that you would move in our hearts, that you would guide our actions, that you would draw us to you, and that you would help us to surrender everything, every dark place to you and to your word. We love you. We confess our sin, and we want to leave it behind. And we want to love as you have loved us. Our words, our actions, our thoughts, God, may they epitomize your son and the sacrifice he boldly made for us. Do a work in this time that only you can. Heal what needs to be healed. Restore what needs to be restored. draw us together into you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand as we sing? You're welcome to come forward if you are comfortable with that. If you'd rather do something more privately, you can head towards the back, or you can email me or fill out a card and hand it to me on your way out. Whatever your comfort level is, and we'll get someone to follow up with you and help you as you build your life on His Word. Guys, you can have a seat. John, you can come on down if you want. Are we clear?